Jesus in the garden. And when Jesus was on the cross, he gave John the care of his mother. Interesting. He wrote a lot of the New Testament. Paul wrote a lot. They say that for every 10 words Paul wrote, John wrote 7. You wouldn't always think that he wrote as much as that, but he wrote a lot of the New Testament. And as you get into the book of 1 John, he has a, you know, God has a purpose in writing it, and there's some problems that he's dealing with as well. Let's read, starting in 1 John 1, I'll just read the first three verses. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we've looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. Just stop reading there for the moment. One of the main purposes God used John to write this book, of course, was to show them the truth. He wanted them to see these aren't just, in another place he talks about, these aren't just fairy tales. These are what we saw and heard. This is what we know. One of the key words in the book of 1 John is the word know. Later on in chapter 3, verse 19, he says, and hereby we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him. John wanted them to be able to know, and to know the truth. But as well, there were already those in the first century who were distorting the things of God. Now, some of the words that they used to describe these folks are Gnostics. You've probably heard of agnostics. They're opposites. Agnostics say, oh, we don't know. Gnostics say, we know, and you should believe everything we say. As well, there was a problem called antinomianism. Now, you know, that's a good word to throw into your conversation every once in a while. An antinomianist basically was a person who said, well, as long as you believe, that's all right. It doesn't have to change your life. Sounds a lot like religion today, doesn't it? Oh, yeah, I believe in God. And, you know, no evidence, no change, no commitment to the Lord. And so he was dealing with all these problems. You know, there's a lot of people who just won't take a stand. They're agnostic. They're afraid to stand sometimes. Someone has said, he who stands for nothing will fall for anything. John is writing saying, we can know. God says, we can know. Some of us probably practice this approach. You know, people ask, what do you believe? I don't know. You know, let me ask the pastor. Sometimes is the answer. Gnostics were the opposite. And there are people like that still today. I know. They thought themselves superior. And it didn't matter. A lot of times it doesn't matter what you're talking about. They're dogmatic about, you know, whatever it is. What kind of computer you have to use. And what kind of car you have to drive. And you know, we've had people in churches where you can't eat red meat, you know. And boy, they're evangelistic about it. They know. And we need to be careful. And we need, especially as Christians, to be careful about acting like we know things that aren't in Scripture. Because I'll tell you what, you start spouting off about these other things, then you try to talk to them about Scripture. And you've already set a pattern with them that you're saying you know something that you can't actually know. And we need to be careful as Christians that we're not Gnostic in our approach to life. Only be dogmatic where Scripture is dogmatic. And Scripture is. There's enough of the Scripture that we can believe and believe strongly. Well, we don't have to make up other things. There's been folks who come down the line all through the years who they have a new way. Oh, we know this is the way. The Mormons, the Jehovah's Witnesses, you know, the Seventh-day Adventists, the Christian Science, and so on. You know, we know we've had a new revelation. You don't know it. If you'll believe us, you'll be right. We need to be careful. That's not the approach. And as he presents this book, he helps us to see we can know, but it's limited by what God's revelation. God shows us that which we've seen and heard and so on. John starts and stays with that which is from the beginning. And just like Genesis, in the beginning, the first verse of the book of John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. Well, he starts the same here in 1 John, that which was from the beginning. I mentioned one of the key words in this book is the word know. Another common and key word is the word fellowship. We'll see that tonight. There's some key themes or contrasts, you know, light versus dark, love versus hate, truth versus error. But we're looking tonight just at the beginning of the book of 1 John here, the life that's real, the life that's real. And let me read those first few verses again. It won't hurt us. 1 John chapter 1, verse 1. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we've seen with our eyes, which we've looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. The life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. The life that's real, it's a life that's given of God. You know, there's a lot of people who are hoping they have the right way, and who are some who even want the right way. The way we know it's real is God has told us and showed us from his word. That God revealed himself in creation. God revealed himself in the Bible. But he most specifically and completely revealed himself in Jesus Christ. And that's what he's talking about here. Jesus said in John 14, he that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And we need to be careful because there are counterfeits. That's one of the things he talks about later in chapter 2, verse 22, for instance. Who is a liar but he that denieth that Jesus is the Christ? He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. You know, there's those who have tried to change the teaching about Jesus. Oh, he's just the son of Mary. Oh, he's just a creation of God. He's the beginning of creation. You know, and it just seems like a little change. But it's denying the Son. And we need to understand that this life is given of God. It's revealed in Jesus Christ. Real life is a person. And when we know and understand about Jesus Christ, that's life. You know, that's the key to it. Secondly, this life is experienced by us, by people. There in verses 1 and 2, he lists a lot of things here that have to do with us experiencing something. We've seen, I thought it was interesting, he says, we've seen with our eyes. He's saying, this isn't just a vision I had, this wasn't a dream, this wasn't an idea. He said, my eyeballs looked and saw it. I saw Jesus. I think that's important. We've looked upon. Our hands have handled. We've seen and bear witness and show unto you. It's experienced. Later on, and he talks six different times in the book of 1 John, he talks about being born of God. You know, it's an experience that changes us. Jesus talked in John 3 about being born again. 1 John 5, 1, whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. When we see the risen Christ, when we see him through Scripture, we're changed. We experience it. They experienced it in a physical way, and they're able to tell us and relate it to us. Real life is revealed in Jesus and experienced when we put our trust in him. And the thing is, knowing Jesus changes us. It's... When I say an experience, don't misunderstand me there. I'm not saying that our experience is what saves us. But I'm saying when we get saved, we experience it. We're born again. It's an actual transaction that takes place. I don't do this very often. I thought I'd share a poem with you. It's called The Touch of the Master's Hand. 'Twas battered and scarred, and the auctioneer thought it hardly worth his while to waste his time on the old violin. But he held it up with a smile. What am I bid, good people? Who will start the bidding for me? $1, $1. Do I hear two? $2. Who will make it three? $3 once, $3 twice. But no, from the room far back, a gray bearded man came forward and picked up the bow. Then wiping the dust from the old violin and tightening up the strings, he played a melody pure and sweet as the angels sing. The music ceased, and the auctioneer, with a voice that was quiet and low, said, "What now am I bid for the old violin?" And he held it aloft with the bow. 1,000, 1,000, do I hear two? 2,000, who'll make it three? 3,000 once, 3,000 twice, gone, said he. The audience cheered, but some of them cried, "We just don't understand what changed its worth." Swift came the reply, "The touch of the master's hand." And many a man with life out of tune, all battered and bruised with sin, is auctioned cheap to a thoughtless crowd, much like the old violin. A mess of pottage, a glass of wine, a game, and he travels on. He's going once, going twice, he's going almost gone. But the master comes, and the foolish crowd can never quite understand the worth of a soul and the change that is wrought by the touch of the master's hand. It's a blessing to realize that our Christianity is not just an idea. God actually does something in our life. He changes us. And physically, he came and he lived and he died and he rose again. And he offers us salvation. This life, the life that's real, is given of God. It's experienced by man. And like I mentioned earlier, we need to watch out for counterfeits. You stop and think about it. You know, you could do some good with a counterfeit. If I had a counterfeit $20 note and didn't know it, I could buy you something nice, as long as they didn't catch me. Some of these cults, they do some good. I've had people where I couldn't get the chance to share the gospel with them because some cult had helped them in their time of need, and they felt like they owed them. Listen, you don't owe anyone your eternity. We need to make sure we get the real thing. And the life that's experienced, the life that God gives, will stand the test of eternity. But then thirdly, the life that's real is shared with others. As you see there in verse 3, "That which we've seen and heard, declare we unto you." You know, when real life comes, you just can't keep it to yourself. You know, there's things in life that we're glad to share with people. Somebody was telling us today about this place they could go and get a really good hamburger. You know, if somebody's got a sale on something, "Oh, you should go down to whatever," you know. There's lots of things like that. Listen, it makes sense that when you trust Christ as your Savior, you're not going to just keep it to yourself. We declare it. Once we've experienced it, we want to share it. And as well, there's no going back. You know, once you've trusted Christ, eternal life, there's no returns on that. The Lord saves you for eternity. And John shares some things that we would share with others. One, there in verse 3, "That we may have fellowship." "That which we've seen and heard, declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us." Now, when we get saved, we know that people need the Lord. And we know that Christians need the Lord. Now, I was thinking about it today. You know, when somebody misses church, sometimes it comes up, we'll say, "Oh, we missed you. Hope you'll come, you know, the next time." And it's not that we are down on them or, you know, trying to make them feel bad. We know that it's a good and blessed thing to do. It'll help them. I mean, I know when I prepare a sermon, you know, there's no bad scriptures. There's no scripture that's, "Oh, we don't need that one." You know, there's always a feast. There's always a meal from God's word. And they need to be a part of that fellowship. A lonely Christian is a Christian who hasn't learned fellowship with the Lord. Really, is what it is. In verse 7, he says, "If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. The blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin." You know, we have that fellowship because of our unity, our standing in Christ. In Corinthians, I think we used this verse a week or two ago. He says in 1 Corinthians 1:9, "God is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord." God wants us to have that fellowship, and that's something that we encourage each other in. You know, we share it with each other. You need fellowship, and when we fellowship with God, that causes us to communicate with others. I meet sometimes people who claim to be Christians, and, "Oh, I'm so lonely." Well, listen, God has a solution for that. It's called the fellowship of the believers. And you commit yourself to it, and you'll find that it'll come back. Throw your, you know, the old saying from the scriptures, throw your bread on the water, and it'll come back. The second thing, not only we share with others that they need fellowship, verse 4, these things write we unto you that your joy may be full. There's several things in 1 John where he says, I'm writing to tell you this. I think there's five different ones at least. This is the second one. Christians need joy. Yeah, we need the joy of the Lord. And that's something we can share with others. And yeah, we sing about it. Jesus is the joy of living. If you want joy, real joy, wonderful joy, you know, it's something that we hopefully have. But, you know, there's things that can take away our joy if we're not careful. I think there's people who don't have the joy of the Lord because they're just pretending to be saved. You know, they're playing a role. They're trying to play the part of a Christian, but they don't have the Lord in their heart. Boy, that makes it hard. There's others who are saved, but they're out of fellowship with the Lord for one reason or another. Disobeying God's will, or not forgiving or loving some other believer, or living a lie in some way. You know, sin is a strange thing. It promises us joy, but it delivers sorrow. You know, sin is, boy, it makes big promises. In Hebrews 11:25, he says that about Moses, he chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. You know, sin says, yeah, come on, you'll have a great time. It doesn't tell you about the end of it. It doesn't tell you where it's leading. Sin offers pleasure, but delivers sorrow. God offers joy, the fruit of the Spirit. We share with people, you need joy. God has it. You know, when we have the life that's real, we share it with others. The third thing is there in 1 John 2, verse 1, my little children, these things write I unto you, here's the third one, that ye sin not. And we share with others, we know, you know as an individual how sin affects you. And you know when others are struggling with sin, it's not a good time. And people need to understand from the scripture that God has given us the opportunity to live in victory over sin. You know, the penalty of sin was solved at salvation. If you're saved, you're not going to hell. But God also has victory over the power of sin. And as we grow in the Lord and as we encourage each other, you know, a Christian who's right with God is not going to, what's the word I want to use here? You know, when somebody else is in sin, you're not going to lord it over them. You're going to have sympathy for them. And you're going to want to help them. God wants us to have victory over the power of sin. And when we share, you know, we share with others, there's victory over sin. In verse 1 there, the next part it says, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father. We can share that with people. Listen, Jesus is praying for you. Jesus is on your side. Verse 2, he is the propitiation for our sins. He's the mercy seat. Man, you spend some time thinking about that. Jesus is our mercy seat. That's where they put the blood when they were dealing with sin in the Old Testament. That's who Jesus is. He's the blood. He's the one that covers our sins. John said, I'm writing that you sin not. There's help. One Christian counselor, he likes to get people to get to the place where they can see what their sin is, because he says, if it's a sin problem, God has help for that. No worries. You know, God can deal with that. It's when we won't say, oh, I've sinned, that we don't get help. God wants us to share these things with others. You need fellowship. It comes from God. You need joy. It comes from God. You need victory over sin. God has that too. Then in chapter 2, verse 26, he tells us another reason he's writing. These things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. I think I wrote in the wrong reference here. Anyway, these things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. He's just saying that we may not be deceived, that we overcome error. Sometimes we deceive ourselves, don't we? We'll read the scripture and we're not careful, and we'll look at it the wrong way, and we won't get the actual message that God is giving to us, or someone else comes along and they're very persuasive or something. God doesn't want us to be deceived. He wants us to have discernment, to overcome error, to know right and wrong. And chapter 2, verse 18, here's an error. Little children, it is the last time, and as you've heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. God doesn't want us to be deceived in what we think about Christ and about the end times and so on. Later in chapter 4, verse 3, every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist. You know, God doesn't want us to be deceived. And as Christians, we need to, that's something that we share with others. That we believe God's word and walk in God's word. There's no substitute for Christ. And we share with others. The truth will set you free. You know, we should be able to sit down as Christians and look at God's word. And if we're wrong, we should be able to see that. One more. Chapter 5, verse 13. This is one you know. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. God wants us to know that we're saved. And that's something we can share with others. It's a sad way to live, to spend very much of your life wondering if you're saved. Yeah, we've probably all gone through it at some time or another. Especially like if you grow up in church, sometimes it's an easy thing as a young person to, you know, to wonder whether you've really made that transaction or not. But God says we can know. That word know, K-N-O-W, is used over 30 times in the book of 1 John. And we can share with each other. You can have assurance. You know, that assurance is not by our feelings. That assurance is not something I can give you or you can give me. That assurance comes from the Word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Listen, if your faith is not in what this book says, you don't have faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. It's not faith just to believe something. I mean, there's people believe anything you can imagine. Faith is believing God. And believing God is based on his revealed word. Listen, it's not some dream or vision or word from whoever. God has given us his word so that we can know. These are things we can share with each other. That this life that's real, it affects us and it affects those around us. God shares the life that's real through the Apostle John here. And when we have the life that's real, we'll want to share it with others. We'll want them to have fellowship. We'll want them to have joy. We'll want them not to be ruled by sin, not to be deceived, to know that they're saved. These are some real basic things, aren't they? The life that's real is revealed in Jesus Christ. And the more you know Jesus, I don't mean getting saved, I'm talking about as a saved person, the more you get to know him. The way I would illustrate that is, some of you may have experienced this, there's a certain way you knew your parents when you were little. Then you grew up. And you knew them a different way, maybe as a teenager, and then as a 20-year-old. And then, as you got older, you began to get a little bit of sympathy for them. you know, we've been through the whole gamut where our parents got old and frail. Now, you don't have that experience with God, but what I'm saying is, as you grow in your Christian life, you get to know more and more of the truth of the Lord, what he's like, who he is, his character, and so on. And it gets gooder and gooder. It gets better and better as you know the Lord. The life that's real is revealed in Jesus Christ. It's experienced by those who trust him, and it can be shared with others. The Christian life is not about just individuals. You get saved as an individual. But God encourages us that in Christ we have the fellowship of the believers. And I want to encourage you tonight, take advantage of what God gives you. Don't be the lone ranger. Listen, when you have trouble, share your trouble. We want to be able to do that. When you have blessings, share your blessing. You know, we ask for testimonies sometimes, and you know, we think just the blessings, but it needs to go both ways. And the Bible says we're going to reap what we sow. Well, we need to be the kind of Christian that others can imitate. Have you been born of God? That's the first thing. Are you in fellowship with God? If you know Christ as your Savior, you have an unbreakable fellowship, but are you enjoying it and growing in what God would teach you. His call is come and enjoy fellowship with him. That's what God wants. Come and share the life that's real. I love that verse where he, in verse 3, that which we've seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. That's the thing that makes our fellowship together sweet, is that it's based on the true God, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's go to the Lord in prayer tonight. Father, thank you so much for your goodness. Lord, thank you for your word. There's so much that we can't even take it all in, Father, but we're thankful that you love us, that you know us, that we can call you Father. And Lord, I know that there's folks in our church going through difficult times. Help them to call on you. Lord, help us to be of help to each other. Lord, I know there's folks going through illness physically, and I pray that you'll bless them and help them. Father, help us to know how to be a blessing. Father, as a church, we have a desire to reach our community for you. Help us, Lord, to share your word with others. Help it to be a from-the-heart testimony of God's grace in our own lives. Thank you for this time together tonight, and we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. You're dismissed. We'll just quit.